Good morning. Now we'll start discussion on a new module, energy production from waste through transesterification. So far we have discussed on different thermal and biochemical routes for the production of energy from the waste and biomass, and now we will concentrate on a chemical route, and the transesterification is an important chemical route for the waste to energy conversion method. And in this process, some waste which is having triglycerides or oil, that is bio oil, can be converted to esters, that is a fatty acid alkyl esters. And these fatty acid alkyl esters are the component of biodiesel. So after this process, the product which we get, that will be having some fuel value and can be used by blending with diesel or directly in the engine. So in this module, we will discuss what is the transesterification, organic wastes for transesterification, production of bio-oil from oil seeds and its major composition, need of upgradation of bio-oil to biodiesel, and then biodiesel properties, upgradation flow sheets, that is bio-oil to biodiesel conversion flow sheets, and steps for upgradation, biodiesel production from mixed waste plant oil or grease, and conversion of bio-oil or biodiesel in diesel engine. So let us start, let us see what is the transesterification. So as the name says, it is esterification process, but it is transesterification. So in this method, as I have already discussed, that is triglyceride. So esters of glycerol, that is CH2, CH2O, COR1, COR2, and say COR3. So this is a triglyceride. So this triglyceride is converted to glycerol, some alcohol reacts with it, basically methanol or higher alcohol may be also used. So let us take some example of methanol. So CH3OH, so some catalyst is used. So this catalyst, it will convert this glyceraldehyde to glycerol, and will give the fatty acid alkyl esters. So R1 COO CH3, R2 COO CH3, and R3 COO CH3, when CH3OH is used. If we use higher alcohol, this alkyl group will be higher. Now this is the basic chemistry or basic reactions of the transesterification process, and in this process some catalyst is used. Without catalyst, the reaction will not take place, and sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide is mostly used. But in some cases, particularly when say in your waste, not only the triglyceride is present, some free acid is also present. So if some free acid is present here, so that will react with sodium hydroxide and potassium hydroxide and produce soap. That is why acid catalyzed transesterification process is also used in some cases, particularly when free acid is present in the feedstock. As I have just discussed, if free acid is present or if free acid is not present, here some free acid first forms, say during the, if we see the mechanism of the transesterification process, the free acid is produced in between. So anyway, it can react with that, and always there is a chance of soap formation for this transesterification process when NaOH is used as catalyst. That is why efforts are on and people are trying to develop new catalyst, that is heterogeneous catalyst to remove this difficulty. So, this is the basics of the transesterification process. So, by this process what we get? We get the fatty acid methyl esters when methanol is used. So, these compounds are the components of biodiesel, but this glycerol is not desirable for fuel applications, but it has immense utility. It can be purified and can be applied in many other applications. So, the triglyceride which is present in the waste materials, that can be converted to value added product by this process, transesterification process, and some of these products will be having energy values. So, now we will be concentrating on this. Before that, we will see how, where from these things are coming, that triglyceride, from what type of waste we can get. So, if we consider different types of organic wastes for transesterification, we will see that all organic wastes are not suitable for the transesterification process. Part of the waste or the will be suitable, those are having some triglyceride, and those are basically waste oil and cooking oil, recycled grease and waste oil seeds. The oil seeds which are having some bio oil inside it or lipid inside it, that can be used for the production of bio oil first and then for its upgradation. So, you see different feedstocks which are available in waste, those will not be processed in the same process. The process steps are different. For if it is the waste is waste oil seeds, then we will go for oil extraction, then bio oil will be produced, bio oil will be upgraded, and then biodiesel will get. And this upgradation is basically transesterification process. If we have waste oil or cooking oil, we will go for upgradation, we do not need for any bio oil production. If we have recycled grease, we will go for upgradation, no need of bio oil. Again, you see here two different waste oil or cooking oil and recycled grease, two different feedstocks are having different properties. Basically, recycled grease are having high amount of free fatty acids in it along with triglycerides. So, acid catalyzed transesterification must be there for the processing of this recycled grease, whereas waste oil and cooking oil, these are having very less free fatty acids and the acid catalyzed step may be escaped. So, these are the different feedstocks or type of wastes which can be processed through the transesterification process. Now, at first we will consider the oil bio oil production from oil seeds, waste oil seeds, and we will see that there are basically two types of operations which are used for the extraction of oil from the oil seeds. One is your conventional method and advanced method. Conventional method means there are some physical method and chemical method. Physically, that using expeller, the oil is taken out, extracted from the oil seeds. So, if we have some oil seeds, if we press it, it will be broken, the cells will be broken, oil will be broken, and the oils will be coming out. So, oils will be coming out. So, this is the mechanism of the expeller press method. But if we use some solvent extraction, so if we use some solvent, say here we have added some solvent, liquid solvent, and some solid particles here, broken solid particles, the broken parts of these oil seeds, or the full part of complete part of oil seed, then what will be happening? The oil which is inside this, that will diffuse and it will come into the solvent. If we break this wall, so we will get more extraction. So, that is solvent extractions is the process through which the oil is first extracted from the biomass or bio or waste or oil seeds. And then advanced methods, these are basically extraction method. Somewhere we use the ultrasonic assisted extraction and somewhere we use supercritical fluid extraction method. So, these are the different methods which have been used for the extraction of bio oil. So, these two, ultrasonic assisted extraction and supercritical fluid extraction, both are under solvent extractions, or we can write the same table in different fashion like this. So we can write say L extraction it is having mechanical and it is chemical, chemical that is solvent extraction that may be of conventional or may be of ultrasonic assisted or may be supercritical. So that way also we can represent this method. Now we will see these are two pictures, the oil press and this is solvent extraction. Normally for the solvent extraction Soxhlet apparatus is used. So as shown in the figure, this is Soxhlet apparatus. The working of this apparatus is like this. Say as we see here, here is the solvent, we heat it, the vaporized solvent will go up, come here, it is condensed, so liquid will form, so liquid solvent will drop here, solids will be kept here, and when the liquid will come here, there will be good mixing between the liquid and solids, and solid liquid will be going to this beaker through siphon action. So this is not very clear, I am drawing here. Say we have one beaker here, say, so we will be putting one okay. So say this is our Soxhlet apparatus, at the top we will be having some condenser so, here we will be sending water, cooling water, and here will be cooling water out. So when we are putting the solvent here, we are putting the material, solid material here, that is from where we are interested to extract, that is solids for extraction here. So solvent it is heated, so heated solvent will go here and the vapor will goes up, condensed, this will drop, and then there will be good mixing of this solid and liquid solvent. Once the liquid is filled here, due to siphon action the liquid solvent will come down here and again come back. So this will be continuing for time, hours, so 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours as we like. So tau with time the same process will be continuing, solvent will be there and there will be good mixing between the solid and the liquid, and from this solid part the oil molecules will come out and mix with the solvent. So this is the mechanism of Soxhlet apparatus using solvent extraction. Now if we use ultrasonic assisted extraction, so in this case the solids or the seeds from where the oil is getting out, the ultrasonic wave helps to break the area, the surface or the wall of the seed, so more oil comes easily. As a whole the rate of the process increases, extraction process increases. Now the factors which affect the oil extractions are mentioned here, that is type of solvent, hexane and n-pentane. So oil is present in the oil seeds, so most of the oils are non-polar, so if we use non-polar solvent we will get more extraction. If we use polar solvent, we may not get that much of extraction. So, biomass to solvent ratio. So, if we use more solvent, we will be getting more extraction of oil because driving force will be higher in that case, but you have to optimize. Then temperature, higher the temperature, higher will be the extraction, but the temperature cannot be so high that it is above the boiling point of that solvent. So, temperature has to be decided on the basis of the solvent which you are using. So, extraction method, what type of extractions, ultrasonication assisted or expeller method, any expeller. So, it will depend upon the extraction method or supercritical extraction may be. Extraction time also, the time of extractions will give more yield, and then moisture content, particle size and shape. Already we have discussed the less of the particle size, more surface area and more contact, so will be more. And moisture content, actually moisture content is not desirable for this solvent extraction phase in conventional way, but gradually, particularly for some peat stocks, particularly for microalgae, the moisture content, moisture separation requires very high amount of energy. So, people are trying to develop some process with high moisture, that is in liquid media, for the extractions of oil. Now, here is the comparison of various lipid extraction processes. So, we have explained here expeller process, and then we have supercritical fluid extraction, ultrasonics and solvent extraction, 4 processes are there. Out of these, the solvent extraction is mostly used, but there is some disadvantage of using solvent extraction process is that the solvents are toxic in nature in general, generally, and it requires large solvent and an expensive solvent recovery and flammable and toxic. So, these are the main disadvantage of the solvent extraction process. Supercritical fluid extraction, the solvent is non-toxic and non-flammable and operation is simple, but it has some disadvantages that extraction of polar analyze, if some polar molecules are present in it, it will be difficult for the separation and limited interaction between supercritical CO2 and biomass. Ultrasonic assisted extractions is one sort of solvent extractions which helps to increase the rate of the production of the bio oil. Now, we will say what is the bio oil and what are the fatty acid content, means the triglyceride which is present in the bio oil, what type of acids are present there. So, basically major 7 acids are there, that is your lauric acid, myristic acid as shown here, that is lauric acid C12H24O2, myristic acid C14H28O2, and then palmitic acid C16H32O2, and stearic acid C18H36O2. These are the saturated fatty acids, and some unsaturated fatty acids are also there, oleic acid C18H34O2 and linoleic acid C18H32O2 and linolenic acid C18H30O2 and arachidonic acid C20H32O2, and these are the structure, and some melting points are given here also. So, here we can get some important information that with the increase of this unsaturation, we are getting lesser melting point. So, high melting point and this is lesser melting point. So, these are sometimes helpful for its use as a fuel. Now, the bio oil which is produced, it requires upgradation. Why the upgradation is required? Because the bio oil viscosity is very high. That is why it is difficult to use directly in engine, because it is difficult to pump the oil, bio oil, to the engine for its automation and then its ignition. As well as if we can use some high pump, high capacity pump, and the droplets will be bigger and combustion will not be complete. So, these are the major difficulty with the bio oil. So, bio oil which is produced from oil seeds or some other waste oil seeds, so those cannot be directly used, that has to be converted or upgraded through the transesterification. That is why the importance of transesterification, that is for bio oil which is produced from the waste oil seeds. Other 2 sources we have discussed, recycled grease and waste cooking oil and waste plant oil. So, these also are waste materials and lose their fuel properties. So, upgradation improves the quality of these wastes, and hence upgradation is required, and transesterification improves the quality of these feedstocks and impart fuel properties. So, that is why we are doing the upgradation, and ultimately the objective of upgradation is to get the biodiesel, the components of the biodiesel, that is fatty acid alkyl esters. And biodiesel is a mixture of fatty acid alkyl esters, and it is non-hazardous. If we see the composition of the biodiesels, as we discussed in the previous slides, the esters here, so we have sufficient oxygen in this compound. So, during combustion it will be completely combusted, unlike petrodiesel. So, this is relatively purer and non-toxic and biodegradable, and it reduces air pollutants such as particulates, carbon monoxide and hydrocarbons and air toxins. So, that is why biodiesel are getting interest. One way, it is having good better quality, as well as it will be also meeting some oil requirement from the waste and biomass. It burns more efficiently than petroleum diesel, and its higher lubricity can reduce the engine wear and prolong its lifetime. So, this is the advantage of biodiesel. But biodiesel can be used as such in the engine, but normally it is used with blend with the diesel, and some commercially available are B20, B9, B2, B1. So, B20 means a blend, that is 20% biodiesel and 80% diesel. So, B2 means 2% biodiesel, 98% diesel. So, B1 means 1% biodiesel, 99% diesel. So, all these blended fuels are used in the diesel engine without its modification. But if we want to use this completely pure biodiesel, we have to take some action. We may need to improve the engine or some other modifications in the systems, we will discuss later on. So, due to slightly less energy density, the biodiesel is having slightly less energy density, that is why when we make the blend, the fuel economy tends to fall 7% for every 10% biodiesel in a fuel blend. So, high viscosity and flash point needs upgradations. Now, we will say important properties of biodiesel are, first one is as percentage. So, as percentage can be determined by proximate analysis, we have discussed in earlier modules, and density, that is the weight per unit volume, the picnometers, specific gravity can be measured. So, we have discussed these things. Here the density is slightly higher than the petrodiesel. The density of biodiesel is slightly higher than that of the petrodiesel, and cloud point and pore point, there are two important properties of the biodiesel. So, what are those? Now, cloud point is the temperature at which oil appears cloudy. That means, say biodiesel or diesel having some, diesel have some wax and bio wax in the biodiesel, those tends to keep some appearance haziness, and it gives to some cloudy. So, the wax starts to solidify, and then cloudy appearance comes. So, that temperature is cloud point. When we reduce the temperature, this type of situation comes first. If we further reduce the temperature, then these will be so dense, the flow of the fluid will cease. So, that is the pore point. Pore point is refers to the temperature at which the well in solid form and starts to melt or pour, that means the flow ceases at this temperature. So, obviously, the pore point will be lower than, pore point is lower than that of cloud point. The pore point will be lower than that of the cloud point. Now, we will discuss on Seaton number. The one most important properties of biodiesel or diesel is the Seaton number. So, what is the Seaton number? That is a relative measure of the interval between the beginning of the injection and the auto ignition. So, injection and auto ignition, if there is some delay, there will be some spark. So, that is the indication of Seaton number. Higher the Seaton numbers, there will be less gap, lower the Schlitter number, there will be more interval between these two. So higher number is desirable, that is 45 to 55 is value is desirable, and this Schlitter number is measured by using a machine. That machine is called fuel cooperative fuel research engine, CFR engine. In CFR engine, under standard test condition, a hand wheel is used to increase the compression ratio so that maximum pressure can be generated, so that the delay between these two will be minimum. The delay between injections and ignition is becoming 2.407 millisecond. So we are using one fuel, we are increasing the compression ratio, and we are getting the gap between injection and ignition is 2.407 millisecond. Then we will be using a mixture of fuel, that is cetane and isocetane. Cetane and isocetane with different ratio. A ratio will come that will be having the similar ignition properties in the same engine, same conditions. So that ratio of cetane will be the cetane number of this oil sample investigated. So cetane number is 100 for cetane and 0 for alpha methyl naphthalene or 1 methyl naphthalene and 15 for isocetane. So initially this was used, the alpha methyl naphthalene, for this measurement, but later on the isocetane has been introduced. Next we are coming to flash point. So flash point is also another important property of any fuel, liquid fuel basically. So flash point in this case, if we heat the fuel, if they raise the temperature of the fuel and put one and keep one fire, open fire in momentarily on the top of it, so there will be some momentary flash. So that is called flash point. So if we raise the temperature, then fire will catch. So that will be the fire point. So fire point and flash point are the important properties of the fuels. So there are two methods for the measurement of flash point. One is closed cup, another is open cup method. The same sample in open cup and same sample in closed cup, if we test for the flash point, we will be getting some differences, that is 5 to 10 degree centigrade lower in case of this, that is the closed cup will be being this lower. So this is the flash point measurement for this oil, and now we will see the heating value and iodine value. Heating value already we have discussed in our previous module, so we are not discussing here. That is the amount of heat released per unit amount of material or the fuel, and it depends upon the CHN concentration of this, which is determined through ultimate analysis. And now iodine value, that is also one important property of this biodiesel. Iodine value gives the indication of unsaturation present in it. So unsaturation present in it, so if say unsaturation is present in it, what is happened in this case for the measurement of iodine value, ICL or IBR, that is iodine monochloride or iodine monobromide solution is added in the fuel, and then this ICL reacts with this CC double bond and this forms this type of structure. And if we add ICL in excess, so the remaining ICL will be available in the solution, we will be adding some amount of potassium iodide, excess potassium iodide, so that potassium iodide converts ICL to iodine. So this excess this iodine, which is now generated in the solution, can be titrated by using sodium thiosulfate. So sodium thiosulfate will be converted to tetrathionate and sodium iodide will form. So by using some indicator by this titration, we can determine what amount of iodine is present in this solution which was not used, and ICL. If we know the initial concentration of ICL, and if we know the now know the iodine unused, so what is the use of iodine, we can calculate. And one mole of iodide attaching with one unsaturation carbon bond, so that is why gram of iodine absorbed by 100 ml of a given oil is the iodine value. So potassium percentage and sulfur percentage, another two important properties of the biodiesel. So when biodiesel is produced, as you have discussed, that potassium hydroxide is can be used as a catalyst, so that can be available in the biodiesel, and that percentage has to be measured. As it is coming from the biomass feedstocks, so it can have some sulfur, so sulfur can be measured. So there are number of methods for the measurement of sulfur. One is very primitive one, that is your colorimetric method, if we use barium chloride in the solution, then it will be having some barium sulfate white precipitate, so white color, and some weak bond combustion method and X-ray fluorescence and ICP-MS is there. So, these are the different methods through which we can measure the sulfur content in the biodiesel. Now, viscosity is another property of the biodiesel which is related to the thickness of this, and this is measured through different viscometers. And as per the Poiseuille's equation, if a liquid flows through a tube, the liquid will be having the minimum velocity at the wall and maximum velocity at the center. So, minimum velocity at the wall and maximum velocity at the center. So, due to the friction here, pressure drop will be developed. Now, this type of flow, when a fluid is passed through a tube or a nozzle, so at that time the flow is defined in that, in this formula, that is the viscosity coefficient is equal to pi into r to the power 4 p into t divided by 8 into v into l, where t is the time, b is the time of flow, and v is the volume of liquid, volume of flow. So, fluid say how much collected, t is the time of flow through the tube, t is the time, l is the distance traveled by the liquid during time, so and r is the diameter of the tube. So, then p is the hydrostatic pressure. So, if we know, then we can get the viscosity coefficient. So, this term is equal to say constant pi r square for a particular system, b, l and r are constant. So, it is equal to k into p into t, and p is the hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure means that is again related to density, so mass related to mass m by v, so it is proportional to k into m into t. So, if we have one fluid, the viscosity is known to that, and another one, the biodiesel, viscosity is not known. So, if we use the same setup for the testing, then we get different mass collection at different time. So, viscosity ratio, coefficient ratio will be eta by eta r, that is equal to m t by m r t r, that is m r is the mass of the reference fluid and this is the mass of the biodiesel, time for the flow, and TR is the time for the flow of the reference material. So, this is the principles through which the viscosity is measured, and there are number of viscosities measurement instruments or the viscometers as listed here. So, this is the comparison of properties of biodiesel from different vegetable oils. If we get from vegetable oils, say soybean oil and babasu oil, it is given here. So, diesel oil properties are given here. So, biodiesel from babasu oil is given and other soybean oil is given. So, here we see the flash point is very very high for the bio oil. So, upgradation is required. After upgradations, we have been able to reduce the viscosity 30.6 to 4.5, and this is the for diesel 3.06, okay, that is millimeter square per second, and flash point is 76, but here we have 254 for the bio oil, it is reduced to 176. So, that way the upgradations or bio oil to biodiesel conversion helps to improve the properties, and here is the comparison. Now, we will see the general flow sheet for the biodiesel production from various feedstocks. So, if we have say vegetable oils, if we have grease, so grease will be having some dilute acid esterification as I have discussed. So, the feedstocks will be going for trans esterification reaction. After trans esterification reaction, we will be getting various products as we have discussed, that the glycerol and alkyl esters, the fatty acid esters of alkyls. So, those will be separated. So, one is glycerin, another is crude biodiesel. So, glycerin will be recovered, and then glycerin will also be having recovered, and the crude glycerin will be going to the alcohol recovery, and then crude biodiesel will further be refined, and will get the refined biodiesel will go for alcohol recovery, and ultimately this is the flow sheet, and we have basically these are the steps: acid esterification, trans esterification, methanol recovery, biodiesel refining and glycerin refining. So, up to this in this part, and the next part we will discuss in next class. Thank you very much.